Good afternoon. I guess you see the signs, okay. You might ask yourself, why should you defend troublemakers? Most of the time when we think of that term, we sort of want to throttle them or make them go away, make them feel unwelcome, and that's what in fact people do often to dissent or to so-called troublemakers. Essentially, my message today though, is that the reason for defending troublemakers, in my judgment, is not the reasons we normally think of, which are well-intentioned, but things like showing respect for people, they should have an opinion and be allowed to express it, you know, or that they might have a truth that we should hear. And usually, though, that doesn't last very, very long when you're well-intentioned. My message today, really, is that the reason for defending troublemakers is because we profit from them, namely for a very practical and very important reason, as I've come to learn. And that's that we make better decisions. We think more clearly. We engage in critical thinking as a result of exposure to dissent. And that's what they give us. And all the studies that we've done, the beauty of it is that it doesn't matter whether they're right or wrong. The fact that they dissent is enough to stimulate this kind of thinking. It was interesting. I was reminded of a discussion about the title of the book. I had a disagreement, a debate, shall we say, with my editor. And his sales team felt very strongly about this title, where I wanted the benign academic title of the subtitle, which of course would bore everyone to death. And they were right in a way that what it did is it appealed to a broader audience who could relate to that concept and what it was like to not only be a troublemaker, but how they deal with it. But more so, rather than what we do as academics, and it was a lesson I learned, is that rather than try to get the content of the book in the title, is to make it an invitation to think about the issue. And I found that that's actually what happened. And so there were like founders of major asset management companies, $20 billion that they were investing. There were organization of cable company CEOs, Vice Admiral of the Coast Guard. And of course, I was always curious about what they found of interest and utility. And I learned a lot from spending time with these individuals. And what became clear is that they understood the importance of leadership in all these issues because they saw it in real-time action. But in addition, they probably more than we many times do as an academic really realize the incredible importance of a single bad decision. And so, for example, there are a lot of them. And single decisions, but with enormous consequences. So, for example, foreign policy, people often use the Bay of Pigs, which is now, of course, very dated. Maybe the invasion of Ukraine certainly is not so dated. Things like surgical mistakes we don't think about, where there are mistakes, whether it's equipment malfunction or whether or not they've actually amputated the wrong limb. It was unneeded brain surgery in some cases, partly from a mix-up of IDs, for a million different reasons. There are single decisions that have enormous consequences, same way in juries. I did for a while death penalty cases, kind of worked with attorneys. Those are life or death decisions, whether or not the jury makes the right decision. And so what I'm getting at is that it becomes something to really think about is the magnitude even of some of the research that we do, particularly once we start to see its potential impact and where it fits across so many other things than, say, in the experimental lab or a single example in our own minds. What happens, I tend to think of three things at once and then I need to stop it, okay. But basically, what the issue here is that, and let me just use one example, a business example, only because it's an easy one to illustrate, is that the merger of AOL and Time Warner, which was done in the year 2000, January 2000, that is considered to be the largest merger in history and the worst. And it's still taught in business schools and every place else all these years later because of its magnitude. And people have gone back and tried to understand it. But basically, what you had was Levin and Case met the CEOs of AOL and Time Warner, respectively, met in the fall of 99. And time was heady with regard to mergers, the dot-com. There was a lot of money to be made. There was access to enormous consumer bases and potential customers. And they knew that it would have historical portions. By January of 2000, we're talking about a matter of a few months, they made a deal for $350 billion. Now, the amount is staggering, because once you get into billions, I almost can't understand it. It's like light years, you know, it's so much money. But more, as important and more important in many ways, is that there were countless job losses, a lot of investigations, retirement accounts were decimated. I mean, it was a major proportions, way beyond the single figure of amount of money lost. But within 2 years, they reported a loss of $100 billion. Ted Turner is reported to have lost $8 billion of his personal assets, which he's continually smarted about, as you can imagine, for many years later. When you go back and you ask yourself, how could they have made a decision that unraveled within months and was so bad? Why couldn't they foresee some of it? And basically, when the little that we know is that the decision-making was done, particularly on the time of Time Warner, by having a group of loyalists, inside people that you trust who are on the same page, and they're all for this wonderful opportunity, so they're looking at ways to execute it, to make it happen. They're not really spending time asking themselves about what could be wrong with the decision. What should we anticipate? They didn't really avail themselves of counter-information. They didn't even really welcome any misgivings from within the company, and there were some. Time magazine head at the time thought it was the stupidest idea ever heard. Others were very aware of the clash of cultures, but they were never welcomed or brought into the discussion. And what I essentially want to argue is that I think that, like probably almost all these other decisions when you look at them, it isn't that they rushed a judgment, it's that they worked to achieve and maintain consensus. You know, we're all told about team player, go along and get along, you know, back the leader, you know, make things happen. And those, it's not that those are bad things to remember, but they have a tendency to essentially talk among ourselves. And we do that as academics, I think, in many ways, is that if we talk among ourselves, we stay in a bubble. Or when you find yourself going out to people in different fields, what happens is that you really enlarge your understanding and thinking. And there's a similar mechanism to some extent that's going on in this. Nonetheless, is that I think part of the problem, in fact, for me, of course, it's a major part of the problem, is that when that merger was done, there was no troublemaker. There was no one that stood up and offered a counterposition. And I'm not suggesting that their importance is because they might be right and persuade you. Often dissenting views don't persuade in the sense that you adopt their position. But my message really today is in some ways a subtle one, but I think a powerful one, is that that dissent changes the way you think about the issue. And what we find over four decades now of doing research related to this is that what dissent does is that it opens the mind. You may not think it's terribly open because you're very much unaware of this. But what happens is you start to think divergently. So it, in terms of what you choose to read, for example, you access information that is on all sides of the issue. You consider the downsides as well as the upsides. Namely, you go through all the things that we wish we could teach you to do or make you do, because teaching doesn't always work into action, as you well know. But essentially, there is enormous profit in the exposure to dissent, mainly because of the way we think, what we're stimulated to think, both in our groups, our organizations, and I'd even add, in our society. There's something about an authentic dissenting voice that changes the nature of thought. Now, I've done this about four times and I keep going in different kind of directions. Basically, though, is that what dissent does, as I said, is opens the mind. And again, there's so many studies, and I will illustrate by one very quick one just so you get a flavor of it. But also what I want to do is to make a contrast with consensus, because it's not just two sides of a coin. They're quite different phenomenon. Much as dissent itself, which we find opens the mind and stimulates this divergent thinking, which is exactly what you want, is that what consensus does, namely, if you don't have that little red fish that was on the cover, is that the mind also is stimulated to think. But interestingly enough is that our studies over and over again shows that the nature of how you think is really quite different. Namely, what you do in your thinking is that you take their perspective. It sounds amazing, except it happens over and over again. You look at the issue from their point of view, so you read things that corroborate their judgment. You end up thinking only of the pros of that judgment. It's almost a form of self-brainwashing. And if I had more time, I'd go into it, but it's exactly what cults do. And the mechanism that they use is essentially to form and create consensus to make sure that it's manifested and exaggerated even by minders, by the people that you're allowed to interact with, etc. But especially what they do invariably is that they punish dissent and they keep it out. We see that in politics as well in many different forms. Once you realize the power of dissent to stimulate that open mind, and once you learn to fear the ways in which consensus can close and narrow the mind, and not just narrow it in general, but narrow it from that perspective. That kind of self-brainwashing is powerful, and mechanisms for it show over and over again in our studies, certainly over many years. To just illustrate by one example of a study, because you know most of the studies are not that easy to explain, is that if I could get this to go forward. Okay, is that one of the studies, we call it the letter string study, is it's very simple, is that if I can't do this under fast exposure, but under fast exposure, if you tell me what the first word is that you noticed formed by these letters. Okay, the first word you noticed, which will happen, is pit. It's the letters, it's the letters formed by the capital letters left to right, the way we read. And we purposely have it that way because we want to know what it is that you're, the position you're going to hold. And it's not anything major. You think, who cares what you first noticed? But that's why in some ways there's power in how much it matters even when it's trivial. Basically, what they're shown is, say, five slides like this, and they're writing down the first thing they notice. We know what they're all going to say, but then they're given feedback. And the feedback is very simple, that it's tip, pit, 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 for example, in this slide. And so for over the five slides, what you're learning is that one of the four people is consistently seeing something different. And we know what that position is, because we've set it up this way, is that it's the backward sequencing of those capital letters. Now that becomes important for us to make the point, I think, that I want to make, which is that after that kind of a feedback, and you know there's dissent, if you will, just at the level of what you first noticed, and it's a they're using that backward sequencing. What's interesting is now if you give them a series of slides, just like these with different letters, and you give them a short time, you know, 10, 15 seconds or whatever, to write down all the words they possibly can form from these letters, you'll notice that you can form letters from left to right, like pit, like pin, like it, okay? You can form them, I've done this a few times, as you can tell, okay? You can also form letters using the backwards sequencing, like ant, A-N-T, okay, or nip, N-I-P. You can also use a mixture of forward and backward sequencing. So things like tan, T-A-N, I'm just sort of making them up right now, or bin, B-I-N. You can see some combination of forward and backward. What's important is that when people are exposed to there being a dissenter who happened to see the backward sequencing of the letters, that's what they first saw, rather repeatedly, so there's a position, is that what individuals themselves now, when they're trying to form all the words they can, what's interesting is that they are, number one, coming up with far more words than any other condition, okay? And secondly, they are finding more words because they're utilizing multiple strategies. They're showing more in the forward and the backward and the mixed sequencing. Now that mind is divergent and it's open and is utilizing the strategies that are available to good performance, okay? Now, a simple, very simple twist on this to give a flavor of it is to make the contrast with what happens when you have consensus. And in consensus, what you're now facing, I hope this isn't going like too fast, but basically, in the consensus condition, when you show this from the beginning and everybody's seeing PIT, P-I-T, now you give them feedback that there is consensus. Namely, there's a majority out there and it's different than yours, okay? So now that backward sequencing of TIP is all three of the other people on the in your group. And so now the feedback is TIP, 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 PIT. So now you feel you're the one person faced with a consensus, essentially, of what they first noticed, and it happens to be the backward sequencing. What happens there with that simple flip is when individuals then are given a series of slides to come up with all the words they possibly can, what's interesting is, what you'd expect, they don't perform better, but it's why don't they? And the why is because they are utilizing backwards sequencing. They are way up, statistically significantly, much higher in the number of words they find using backwards sequencing, but it's at the cost, at the price of finding words using forward or mixed. Namely, it becomes one of, no one study matters, but the body of work supports that, that what happens with consensus is that you view things from their framework. And so now what's happening is that you're using backwards sequencing and not using things that you would normally use, say in the control group. That becomes just one kind of illustration, but the fact is that the studies in many different forms show that kind of a thing. If you see what do people want to read after being exposed to a consensus opposed to dissent, they want to read on all sides of the issue when it was dissent. They want to read on just why the majority, the consensus is what it is by focusing on the reasons for that position. So what you read affects obviously how you think. We find in many ways if they have a solution that they find, say, to some stimulus array, is that you focus on that solution and you won't be able to see it. You won't even peruse the other options. Well, what dissent does is you're perusing those other options, and in addition, you're detecting solutions you wouldn't have seen otherwise. Now, it's kind of a mouthful in a short time, but there's a lot of studies, but what I'm trying to make the point is that it's not a single study or a single kind of aspect of it. Is that in many different ways in which we think about an issue and make decisions, in many different ways in which we know what is good decision making as opposed to poor, is that we profit from dissent, and it shows up over and over and over again. The other thing that we learn is that we learn to fear consensus, and we should fear it anyway. I mean, I know maybe there's truth in numbers, maybe there's untruth in numbers too, okay? What you really want is a critical assessment and an ability to be independent. We've long known, certainly in social psych for, you know, practically a century, of the power of the majority or of consensus to get you to follow them or agree with them. So, you know, we see 90% of verdicts are the position of the majority on the first ballot. You find, you know, people wait in line for a new Apple product because they construct the long line to mean consensus, reviews on books. It's a business model practically. It's so powerful in terms of conformity, as we often used to talk about it. I think the more important aspect is the power of consensus is that we follow blindly. Many times people are not assessing the information. They'll go to bizarre untruths when there's consensus. And we know that part of the reason is a sense in which they can't be right and everybody else is wrong, and mixed with it is a fear of sticking out. So the repercussions are very real, and I can't dissuade you of that, but what I do know is that that's another reason to fear it. But if that's not enough, I think a more insidious aspect is that consensus shapes the way we think. You know, we laughingly talk about bubbles or bias or whatever. We can stay micro on each little issue and think we can train people out of it. But the fact is that there's a powerful mechanism of dissent that really governs how we make decisions, how we think about an issue, what we end up believing. And I think that, which is harder to study in many ways, but I think it's fundamentally very powerful and very important. Getting a little ahead of myself, because I was going to show you this and have you try to do the forward, backward, and mixed sequencing, which you probably were doing as I was speaking anyway, seeing what words you could come up with. But these are just more kind of illustrations of it, where you have the forward, backward, and mixed, which I've already addressed. The bottom line of my message today, really, it comes almost in the form of what I thought was a really a nice graphic from the publisher. And that graphic, of course, is the one with the little red fish, because it sort of exemplifies something people do understand and can relate to, rather than the formalized term of dissent, for example, which sounds, you know, somewhat removed from human beings. That little red fish makes a heck of a lot of difference, is the bottom line. And so when I take it out, you know, in order to show the contrast, is that that left portrait without the little red fish is consensus. And that, I think you should fear, or at least be aware of its power, and examine some of the reasons for it. But that is one that I think the insidious part is that it's not just kind of beware of what you're kind of buying into or agreeing to or following, it buys into actually the way you think yourself. The presence of that little red fish, what we find over and over, may not persuade you in the sense that you agree with them, but I can almost guarantee you it will change the way you think, and for the better. It doesn't shape it in one direction. What it does, it opens it to multiple directions. And over again, we find that decisions are better. I'm not saying that the merger of AOL and Time Warner wouldn't have happened, but it would have happened with far more critical analysis and far more reasoning and far more consideration of the downsides as well as the upsides had there been dissent that had been welcomed and listened to. So, and again, I'm very aware of time, particularly in this setting. But the issue of focus, let me sort of finish with one other example. The issue of focus, namely the fact that you focus on a position posed by a consensus to the exclusion of other things, whether it's backward sequencing in that kind of almost trivial example, or whether it's where you're not, where you pay attention like in a stimulus array, you simply don't look elsewhere, and that's what we find. But to go back to kind of things that we can relate to more as human beings, and right now as flying passengers, I thought about this yesterday, as a matter of fact, coming in, is that in 1978, there was an example of focus that had, again, one of those single bad outcomes. And it was United Airlines 173, and it was going from JFK to Portland with a stop at Denver. And basically, on approach to Portland, they started to put the landing gear down, and there was a loud noise, and the plane itself had kind of taken almost like a sharp turn. It really clearly moved. They knew something was wrong, but they didn't know what. So they wisely put the plane in holding pattern and spent the time investigating the landing gear with an eye for trying to solve it, obviously. To make the story very compact, it's that they continued doing this, and the last 13 minutes I was reading, because they have a documentation of the conversation in the cockpit, but just 6 miles short of landing, the plane fell out of the sky. And there were a number of deaths, many more injured, and it's sort of like, how could that happen, that the plane would fall out of the sky? And it's because they were so focused on attending to the landing gear problem that they didn't pay attention to the fact they were running out of fuel. And you think, that should be like 101. If I've got, you know, so much fuel left, I know, you know, even our cars, you know it's going to stop, and in that case, going to flame out. What I found most chilling about the conversation, in a way, you can imagine from the perspective of consensus and dissent, is that it's not as though no one was paying attention to the fuel. There were people even reporting, because they were asked, how much fuel remains? And they'd say 3,000 pounds left. And then I remember right after it was reported 3,000 pounds, when the captain then was saying, he said, well, it's 3,000 pounds, make it 4. I think, what do you mean, make it 4? You know, when you're in that kind of a situation. But that's the nature of it. It became clear that someone was aware of diminishing fuel, but didn't speak up, only reported it in a very matter-of-fact way. Now, from the perspective of this research, that's very important, because there wasn't that voice that went in to say, we're running out of fuel, we need to pay attention, how much time do we have remaining? Some way in which they knew they were going down, 50, 20 minutes before the plane fell out of the sky, but that wasn't done. So in many times, the National Transportation Agency, then in reflecting on, you know, what went on, they use that kind of bureaucratic speak of, well, the captain and the crew didn't properly communicate with one another. It's like, what does that mean? You know, it's sort of like, at some level, it's like, why does someone who knew the importance of fuel and was reporting and monitoring it didn't speak up and kind of insisted to be taken into account? I, for one, believe, I'm not sure it would have saved the entire day, but it sure as heck would have been better than it was, to be caught unawares where the captain, when they lost the first engine, a matter of like 3 minutes or so before it fell out of the sky, was told that they were flaming out and they lost an engine. He asked this, I still remember, it's chilling, he said, why? And the answer was one word, fuel. And you thought, that's all you say now? I only say this because, not to just be extra dramatic, but part of that's a reason maybe, but to illustrate that These kinds of things that we pay attention to where you're focusing or whatever can make enormous differences in life and in death. And so I'm left with the bottom line message of fear consensus, welcome dissent, and the last thing I'd like to leave you with is dare to be a troublemaker. We're afraid of it, we know the consequences, but I'm convinced that you will benefit your group, your organization, your society, and that whenever you worry about the problems with being a dissenter, also think all of our research shows you might not be liked, but you will be admired. And there's a level at which we take heart in looking even in contemporary ways about the Navalny's or the Zelensky's or even the Larry Tribes, but who are willing to speak up with an authentic voice, and the magnitude of their possible impact on the quality of decisions in life can be enormous. So with that, I thank you. And there's Q&A afterwards in Area B. Thank you.